and welcome back to this week's Jags cast, this week's episode. As you can see, we're joined by the usual suspects, plus our special guest, and it's brought to you courtesy of Scottish Football, and by the letters G, I, R, U, and Y. And for those of you that are maybe a wee bit older and they'll remember the Clangers, and there's a similarity, obviously, with Scottish football, you know, these days, and they had their own language, eat green soup and blue string pudding, so no, it's changed there either. So welcome along to the panel of Donners, Mr. Jags 365, Alan Fraser, and welcome, Big Mad Mental Martin Hardie. Martin, great to have you on the show. Thanks very much for coming on.
How you doing, guys? All right?
Super. Martin, are you still happy with that nickname you were christened all those years ago? Are you fed up with it now?
No, I'm a bit fed up with it, I must say. Obviously, when I played, and especially getting the nickname at Partick Thistle, it was due to the fact that I think my playing style and being moany and grumpy when I played, and then obviously scoring a few goals for Partick Thistle, and the highlight was always predominantly running alongside the Jackie husband and celebrating with the Thistle fans. But now, as I'm getting a bit older and I'm not in the day-to-day grind of winning, etc., I would probably say I'm more laid back than what I am big, mad and mental, as I would call
it. Well, when you look back to those days, I mean, you were kind of late to senior football, because you were, what, about 21 when you kind of joined Queen's Park, and then you went to East Stirling, and that was where this will pick you up. But did you not have a trial with Man United?
Yeah, so before, obviously, I mean, like when you're playing boys club, I played with Clyde Bank Boys Club from the age of 12 right up to 16. So it was like an academy as such, but as we call it, it was boys club. And when I went up into high school, into first year, I was taken to Manchester United on trial for a week, which was a great experience. Going down there, and I always remember that we were taken to the Cliff, which was their training base. And I mean, wee skinny kid for Clyde Bank, and then there was five of us went down. Alan Johnson, Brian McLaughlin, who played obviously for Celtic Scotland. Alan Johnson, as you know as well. There's a boy who played for Pollock Boys Club as such, and there was two boys for Edinburgh, and myself obviously went down. And we were taken, after obviously we'd played games, training, etc., we were trained by Nobby Styles. The man. That was something that I always remember from that. And there must have been easily 80 to 100 kids from all over. So as I say, it was a great experience. Being able to say that I was asked to go and trial. I've still got the letter, I've still got the training top in a bag, as I've told you. the old deal's been up clearing the law for some space. So yeah, that was obviously, and then I kind of fell away a wee bit for football, kind of the usual. You're either going to progress or you go with your pals, etc. And I kind of just chose to go with my pals, no through fault of my own. And then I get the love back for it, playing for Yoker Juveniles in the kind of juvenile under-21 league. And then I was picked up by Queen's Park.
It's quite rare these days. Usually kids are in the system very young. You know, but there's a lot of famous people in the past. I think Ian Wright, guy, I'm sure there's some others, but, you know, who started that kind of same path as you and joined at a later day. It certainly did not your career, did it?
No, I don't. I was really driven, you know, see when I signed for Queen's Park, and I always remember when we were speaking about Boys Club there, that Celtic tried to sign me when I think I was 15, and I was told no, because they've got that many players that you're better off staying with Clyde Bank. And I always remembered that, and then when I was given the chance to go to Queen's Park, I took that opportunity. Now, going from juvenile football to going to play with Queen's Park was, they were really, really fit players, do you know what I mean? So I was always kind of, this was my, I would probably say my apprenticeship, if you know what I mean. So I was there to kind of play with the experienced players in the reserve league, etc., and then travel with the first team. And I was used more as a sub in my first year there. So I was kind of playing catch-up. But after that first full season, when I done pre-season, I then became driven to try and become a better player. And I think every year I went on throughout my career, I did eventually do that.
Well, when we signed you, we got you from East Stirling. I think we paid, did we pay about £20,000, I think, John Lambie paid for you, allegedly.
Allegedly, no. I think sorry for interrupting there, Raymond. No. I think it was £3,000.
Was it?
I think £3,000.
These figures never come out properly, do they? They're never accurate.
Because you know what I mean? I don't know why it was at the time, but there was only 6 weeks of the season left and I was under 24 by roughly 4 weeks because I signed, I think, on the 2nd of April or something, or maybe the end of March or something. And my birthday was the 22nd of April, so I must have made a cut-off just prior to the kind of Bosman, if the Bosman was out, but there was a law that under 24, then you could sign for another club or something like that. So
It probably was £20,000, just that Lambie get a prize pitch.
somebody get £17,000 in their pocket anyway. It wasn't Martin.
Correct. It certainly wasn't myself.
Well, as you said, I mean, you made your mark in those last six games. You got a couple of goals, you know, towards the end of that season. And then the following season, well, that was the second division as it was League One now. You know, it was a tremendous season. And, I mean, you had an absolute couldn't miss period. What was it, 9 goals, December, January of that season. You and Trigger, Paul McGrillen, Danny Lennon, Stephen Craigan, and Peter Lindau. And you had the following season and you played with Peter Lindau. Lindau, obviously, for the promotion game, scored the hat trick up at Stirling. What was the contrast between the two players, Martin?
Between
Peter and Scott, between Trigger and Lindau, yeah.
Obviously, the two of them were fantastic players. If I touch on Peter Lindau first, Peter was a big physical striker in stature, 6'2", same height as myself, well built. But one thing that Peter did have was unbelievable feet. He was great on the ball. And as you've probably remember throughout that season, Peter produced on the occasions where at times when Peter received the ball, you were unsure what he was going to do because a lot of the times when he was left one-on-one, he would obviously turn the defender inside out and produce the goods by scoring, as we've seen in the videos from the Stirling Albion game. And he was a big striker, wasn't he? Obviously, he's from Sweden, so he wasn't a big guy who played up front and held off defenders and won headers. He always naturally gifted, wanted the ball to feet. And then we had Scott McLean, aka Trigger, who him and myself built up a great rapport when we were at the club. And I think did Scott sign for Thistle for, I think it was £40,000 or £50,000, maybe for Inverness. And he showed his quality. And I mean, nowadays Trigger would have been worth easily £250,000. Powerful striker. And when he actually opened up the legs and he got going, see, over 40, 50 yards, Trigger was rapid. And he had a great train of thought. But as soon as he got in that penalty box, he was lethal. A player who probably should have done better in his career. But he was a great player who I enjoyed thoroughly playing with at Partick Thistle.
You know what, Martin? I always thought that, looking back to Thistle strikers, I personally thought Scott was the best with his back to goal. He reminded me like a Viduka, you know. I thought he was unplayable. The way he used to change direction, you know, ball at his feet, he was fantastic. We were looking at the semi final against Rangers, and he caused Amoruso and that a lot of problems. You wouldn't expect a striker in a league below. And I was one of my disappointments with Scott is that, you know, he didn't get a run in the team in the Premier League. I think Lambie chased him, didn't he?
I think, obviously, as you say, the year that, obviously, the second division, the first division, Trigger was scoring, I think he actually scored, might have been 18 in the second division, and then roughly 14, 15 in the first division. But again, then, in the Premier League. I don't nobody knows why. Even the players, we were kind of a wee bit shocked to see that later on, just throughout the Premier League year, that Scott was allowed to leave and go to St Mirren. But because, as I say, he was a fantastic striker. Used to hold the ball up for the midfielders to support, and obviously that was my job, was to get up and support and obviously go beyond as an attacking midfielder. So again, yeah, he was a fantastic player for Thistle and probably should have done a lot more. It was sad to see that obviously the group, I know the group that won the second division was split up relatively quick after the season, and then to the gaffer's miracle working, he brought in a squad of Jerry, Jamie Dolan, Flea, Paddy Kelly, Mark McCulloch, just to name a few, that progressed us again, and we managed to win the first division, and that kind of squad maintained itself getting into the Premier League, added with a couple more. But I think it would have been nice to have probably seen out the SPL season with Scott McLean on that side as well.
How's he keeping these days? Have you been in touch with him?
I've just sent him a wee message. Obviously, I've seen a couple of updates on his Facebook page. Yeah. Just that obviously he had a wee minor stroke. I don't know if a lot of fans maybe know that, but he was taken into hospital, he got better, but then I think he had to go back in. It wasn't a setback or nothing. I think it was just to kind of make sure everything was okay, but no, I think he's doing fine, and hopefully he does get better throughout this period.
Well, I was just going to say, pass on all our best wishes to him.
It's been good actually, Martin, I've been mates with him on Facebook as well, and it's been good to see him back. He's starting to come back to the old trigger and the moaning and everything like that again. So that's when the old trigger's getting back to normal. There was one game in that 2001 season, the second division. Okay, I wanted to remind you about this because I remember we'd won a promotion, Martin, up at Stirling, and we could win the league the following week at Far Hill, and in typical Thistle fashion, we kind of decided we'd extend it a wee bit. Do you remember the Queen of the South game where we had three players sent off, including yours truly?
Bloody hell, I forgot about that. How did I forget about that?
Yourself, wee dog, Stephen Docherty, and Mark McNally.
I can remember the referee was, to use the phrase, which is maybe not a great phrase, he was a wee Hitler-like referee. So as soon as you spoke to him, he was like down your throat, no one to communicate or nothing, and that's what players like. And I don't know why Stevie Dock gets sent off, but I know that Now had been booked, and then I get booked. Now would then get sent off, and I'm giving the ref it, and the next minute listen, Martin.
Aye.
Take a step back before you end up in the changing room. He just reached for the card, and I went, oh, here we go. But funnily enough, Niall's in the changing room, and he's sitting, you know, I don't believe it, I've been sent off, chance for us to win the league. And I've come in, and he's like, oh, sorry, big man, obviously, my mistake. Who went on for you? And I went, nobody. She's actually sent off as well. And he's like, what? He's good. So, I mean, that was kind of typical Thistle, if you know what I mean. We'll have to extend it.
Do you know, I'd forgotten about that game, but it's just come back clear to me. It was, as you describe him, the phrase card happy. He couldn't wait to flash that bloody card about, could he?
what was Lambie and Jerry Collins like with guys like that? Because they were the shrinking violets, weren't they? Would he just get tore into him?
To the referee or to us for being sent off?
No, we know he get tore into you, but no, I'll talk about the referee.
I think it was more Jerry Collins would get tore into the referee, because Lambie was very cute that way, where you would hear him shouting and moaning at the referee, but he would be giving the linesman a wee cuddle. If you know what I mean. But Big Jerry was just obviously full on. You this, that, and the next thing, do you know what I mean? So But as I say, thankfully we obviously won it the week after.
Right, we won it up at Forfar. So, see, getting into the first division, what was the expectations of the players and the team? Because I remember speaking to John a few years ago, and funnily enough, talking about you, he said he was one of your best ever signings because you'd run through a brick wall for him and you'd goals in you and everything. And John had said, at the time, he'd said to me a few years ago, he said, we weren't really expecting to win the league. But what was the expectations amongst the players?
So, from I'll give you my personal point of view. So that's when I went from being a part-time player to becoming part of the bricks and mortar of Firhill being a full-time player. So that was a massive step for myself. And when we went up and we done the pre-season, and as I say, the gaffer brought in a load of brand new players and really experienced players, Jamie Dolan, Jerry Britton, Flea, all had played Premier League. So when they came in, we thought, right, we've got a decent wee squad here. We can hopefully stay up mid-table. And if you ask most of the players from that squad, and obviously we kept a few from the season before, we were thinking, yeah, if we get mid-table, we'd be happy with that. There's no disgrace in saying, coming from winning the league before to going for a mid-table position in the championship, the first division. And you've got to remember that some of the teams that were in the league that year were really good teams. I mean, obviously, the first team we played, St Mirren, had come to the Premier League. You had a strong Ayr United, you had Airdrie, you had Falkirk. I'm trying to think, there was a couple of part-time teams in there, Arbroath, if I can probably remember right, and I can't remember who the other part-time team would have been, but there was a lot, it was a strong league, and for us to obviously go into that, sorry, Inverness and Ross County, they were the two teams in the league, so for us to come into that, we were obviously expecting to hopefully finish mid-table, but I think it was roughly about October, we were maybe sitting third place, and then we started creeping and we started winning games, and the momentum was swinging with the team. And obviously, you had the players who were classed as the experienced players, Danny, Big Jerry, Jamie, Flea, galvanising the team, and then us kind of not so much experienced players were just kind of, we were just riding along the crest of a wave with such playing teams. And I think because we had won so many games the year before, that we just felt as if we could play the same way we did and then just kind of beat teams as we did the year before. I think I can always remember that I think we played, and it was around about the December time, we played St Mirren, Big Kenny Arthur makes the save for the penalty. And I come on as a sub and I scored, but we got battered, absolutely battered for St Mirren that day. And listen, if the other team don't score, no matter how much pressure they put on against you, if you can put the ball in the back of the net at the other end, that's what football's all about. So that was that kind of period there was, I think it was the catalyst for us to go into the following, well, the next year, obviously the same season, but to really go and push and push and push. And I think Lambie, I think the gaffer, he must have brought in two players in that transfer window, which obviously we probably needed.
Toasty came in, of course, as well for St Mirren, which was a surprise to everybody.
Yeah, Toasty was a fantastic signing for Partick Thistle, I think. Maybe because St Mirren had come down for the Premier League and we had the momentum. Maybe he read the signs that, by the way, they could win the league here and I could be back up playing in the Premier League in roughly 4 or 5 months. He was a fantastic player. Real quality on the ball. And it showed, obviously, when we did play in the Premier League.
I mean, it's great to hear you say that, Martin. When you talk about fantastic players, I mean, in that season, that first division season, you scored 14 goals from midfield. I mean, think about that. I mean, nowadays, that doesn't happen. you know. But you weren't really a goal scorer, you know, prior to coming to Thistle. What changed?
It was the gaffer.
Aye.
When I played with Stirling, I always did have an eye for goal. Every team I played for, I scored every season in my career. But I would only score roughly 4 or 5 because I was a left midfielder. I played, I got forward, I went up for corners. I would shoot on sight whenever I could. But then when I went to Thistle, the gaffer, and at that time we were kind of playing a 3-5-2 at times. So when you've got the likes of Danny Lennon and Senator Park, who has got all the experience in the world, he's the one who goes and gets for the defenders and he builds up the play, which, and to be fair, the gaffer just says to me, listen, son, when the ball goes wide, hit the box, get in the box, score goals.
How easy
is that? Simple as that, yeah.
But I mean, that's, and it's something that I just thought, right, well, I'm not going to go and get the ball for a defender and turn and play it to fullbacks and then try and support, because the length of the pitch at Firhill was big enough, but trying to get from box to box, which I thought I'd done pretty well because I did have a defensive duty as well. But as soon as I seen Danny, I just thought, right, I'll wait till the ball goes into the other half, and then that's when I become alive. I know that it's either going to come to me on the left-hand side at the jockey and I'll try and create something, but when it's on the right-hand side, I'm now the third striker. And I think a lot of that's been lost, really. I would probably say in the last 6, 8, 10 years that midfielders, they're there to support and they're there to create as well, but you don't really see many midfielders these days going beyond the strikers and being the one who's getting in the box, because strikers are coming short, they're laying it off, they're going wide with the ball. But as I say, when you've got that licence and you've got the security of Danny there orchestrating things, then it played into my strengths as an aerial player as well as technically, do you know what I mean? Because there was times where I did score with my feet with Thistle. But you've got the security there, Danny. So I think it was just the gaffer had made that decision that, listen, son, I just want you to get in the box and you support the strikers.
Yeah.
It shows you how much trust you placed with Danny Lennon on the ball. And I think people probably forget what a good player he was for us. How he's got the ball, he's safe with the ball, he's going to use it, he's going to play it to somebody else, and you just get forward. And we're going to get to that box, you know.
That's it, definitely. I mean, Danny had a fantastic career before he actually came to Partick Thistle. And when he did, when I eventually came to the club and realised this guy is a really experienced player, but you could tell he was also technically gifted as well, Danny. I mean, although you see him playing the wee short passes and that, Danny was technically gifted. And Danny actually had an eye for goal as well, I think. Each of the years that we all played together, I think Danny would chip in with maybe 4 or 5 goals for midfield as well, because we were always on the front foot, second division and first division, probably more so back foot in the Premier League. But I think there was so much trust because he was a captain. He was a captain of the side. He was the leader of the side. The gaffer had put so much trust in him as well. But also, behind him as well, we had fantastic centre-halves, we had fantastic full-backs who would create things. We were a strong defensively side built to go forward at pace with an energy and they could create and score goals.
You know,
what was Inverness? You did me like 5 goals in 7 games that season to do something to you.
I think it was a journey. I was just obviously trying to get relegated. But no, it was, I think when you always have one team in your league that you play against when you know, I'm good for a goal here. And I think obviously that season, every time we seemed to play Inverness, that I would be good for a goal. Obviously everybody remembers the 2 up at Inverness kind of post-Christmas time, with the Scottish Cup replay at home. Obviously, there's more that I can't really remember, but they're the ones that stick in the memory. And as I've said to you before, that after the Scottish Cup game at Fir Hill and the quarters, Nicky Walker comes up to me and says, "Big man, you've got me in your mantelpiece." You know what I mean? Because obviously Nicky was an experienced goalkeeper and he played for Thistle as well. So that was pretty pleasing for him to say that. But on that basis, that I think, as I say, you're just playing against... I don't really recall who I was playing directly against, but obviously I must have had the upper hand against them.
Definitely. See, like, obviously, you know, 5 goals in 7 games. I think maybe we don't give Lambie the credit. You know, tactically, I mean, in your career, you had some guys that went to the top level, imagine. I know you played at McInnes, who was down south, obviously, successfully. Aberdeen, Owen Coyle was down in the Premier League. You know, but I mean, Lambie, if you remember, guys, we had Albert Craig, who scored a similar amount of goals in midfield as Martin. Maybe that was Lambie given the credit tactically is what he deserved, or because everyone just knew him as a madman, didn't they?
I don't think the gaffer get the credit it was due, because I don't mean this to be bad on the gaffer, but the teams that the gaffer built, as he mentioned before, you need a couple of head cases on your side. And that, as I say, we were very strong defensively. Tactically, we didn't do shape. We didn't need, on the training field, right, when the ball goes here, as the players do now, we were streetwise players. We sorted the problems on the pitch. Danny would orchestrate everything, come in here, we'll tuck in a wee bit if we're maybe under the cosh a wee bit. And then obviously the gaffer, his planning and preparation was second to none. Some of the training that we used to do was baffling, I must say, at times. And you're thinking to yourself, why are we doing this? But again, it was cute because it was fitness related. But we were wanting, obviously, more short-sided games. And there was a lot of fun times at training and stuff like that as well. But there was times when it was grueling and you're thinking, come on, gaffer. We've done enough, but you throughout probably the first division, I would probably say we scored a lot of goals late on, which is testament to obviously your training and your fitness. So, I mean, as I say, the gaffer didn't probably get as much credit as he did, because obviously the type of character he was and the squads that he'd built throughout his probably whole Thistle management career throughout all the stages, you know.
Mm-hmm. You wonder what a modern day sports scientist would think of his training techniques, eh?
No, I think this day and age, a sports scientist would pack up the laptop and I think he would walk in the door.
I think the other thing that season, Martin, obviously there was such a run, and then obviously, as you said, the quarterfinals, but then the semi final against Rangers, which you missed out on.
Yeah.
Suspension.
So we're up at Inverness, obviously big Scotty Pease scored the free kick, an absolute worldie. Must be the 91st minute, and we've got a throw in right at the halfway line, just at the dugout. And instead of, I can remember Ree Flee was playing left back and I was playing obviously left midfield. Now I've picked the ball up and I'm thinking, if I throw it up the line, we're not pushing too many people up the park. So I've got the ball in hand and the gaffer's shouting, "Yeah, you got the park." And Fleece took the ball for me and I'm going, no, you stay back. I'll throw it up the line. The next minute, Robot and the ref, he's just went, blew the whistle, yellow card. And I'm like, "John, ask me out of the semi-final. Time wasting."
did they not even give you a wee warning first? I mean, what are these guys like?
Oh, again, just obviously... because the gaffer was communicating between myself and Flea, and then I'm communicating with Flea, and I'm saying, "No, you stay back now." And then the next minute, he's got the.
So you weren't even deliberately time wasting; you were just getting confused messages for your teammates and your gaffer.
So that was a real sickener for me, because I'd never played in a Scottish Cup semi-final, i.e., or final, etc. At Hampden. I mean, I'd played many games at Hampden with Queen's Park and obviously for Thistle when we won the second division against Queen's Park, but to get to a national semi at Hampden would have been it would have been a great achievement personally. But it was great that the club got to a semi-final. Unfortunately, like kind of most of the small clubs, you're going to be playing against one of the other teams from Glasgow. So unfortunately, it was for us that we fell short. But I'm sure that obviously the fans had a great day out.
And unfortunately, it's been the last time. That was the last time we were at a national semi-final, do you know? And it's been a bugbear for the fans because we've had sides good enough. We've just been unlucky, you know? And we're looking at some of the highlights in that game. You know, made a big difference in that side because we had a lot of possession, some chances in that first half, but just no cutting edge to put a bit of pressure under Rangers, you know?
I think the Rangers, I think we gave them a good game, but we ended up falling short and falling away in the end. But you get a goal earlier in the game, you know, you get it back to one each or whatever. It's a different game, but, you know, wasn't to be.
And at the end of the day, we paid our bills at the end of that game and they didn't
pay. There it is. Donald's talking, Dig. Donald hated the first division and, you know, do you remember the Scottish Cup day, Donald? And
Not really, to be honest. I'd have been, 13?
Aye.
12, maybe. Aye, so I think I probably wasn't allowed to go because it was against one of them, which my dad did never took me to in those days. So I was probably aware it was happening, but kind of already.
I was just going to say, in a personal point of view, my kids were about 8 and 5. They started the second division season, and we started going regularly. And that season, the second division one and the first division one, that's made them Thistle fans for life. So can I just thank you for that, Martin?
I mean, it's pleasing to hear that families are taking their kids. And I think that's something the club have always managed to try and do, that under-16s go free, etc. Because that's the age where if you can take them to a Thistle game and they start winning, then obviously the backing is going to be there if they're with the parents. And then as soon as you see the club winning a league and they celebrate, because I think the both years that we won the league, I think more so kids and a few drunken fans were kind of on the pitch with celebrating. But it's something for the kids to remember. And as you say, that's why you end up becoming a Thistle fan for life.
Well, I've just been having a wee look this morning and I've discovered loads of photographs that I didn't realise I had from that season that I've taken myself of, my kids at games and you lot celebrating the second division championship, etc. So I'll dig through some more of them and maybe pass them on to you at some point.
Yeah, definitely.
And Raymond, and we just missed out another national semi-final except for a penalty shootout at Parkhead, is that right?
Well, I was just coming to that. The following season, obviously, we're in the Premier League. You scored the winner in the League Cup to set up the quarter-final tie. That season was about staying up. And then there was a game at Parkhead, the penalties, and also a goal that was chopped off, if you remember.
Yeah. If we talk about the goal that was chopped off, I mean, I'm positive it was Trigger that hit the header.
Yep.
Yeah. And it's like that beyond the goal line, and I think it was Jamie Smith had headed it back out, which again, you don't get any things when you play at Celtic Park, do you know what I mean? Because obviously of the crowd and because of who you're playing against, do you know what I mean? You don't get any decisions, but what an effort we put in, taking a squad like that to extra time and then penalties, and unfortunately, I've missed a penalty. It's Jerry Collins' fault because I remember Jerry Collins, right? And I know where I put my penalties. Know that I was a great penalty taker, but where I hit the penalty, obviously, went over the bar, and I would never hit a penalty like that. Mm-hmm. I remember Big Jerry saying, "Big man, if you're going up, just smash it. Just hit it as hard as you can." And I'm going, right, I'll put it down the middle. The goalkeeper's diving. Most people are all right-footed, so they're going to the goalkeeper's right, our left. And then as soon as I walk up, and I was really confident walking up as well, I thought, because it was a chance to win it. And I thought, what a chance this is, do you know what I mean? Putting Celtic out, and especially that side that they had under Martin O'Neill, you know what I mean? I can't remember what the scoreline was. I think it was something like 14-13 or something like that. It was totally disappointing. But as you say, the main priority for us that season was staying up.
It's still, probably, my memory's the best goalkeeping performance I've ever seen for a Thistle keeper that night, Kenny Arthur. He was immense. He saved everything, didn't he?
I can't really remember Kenny's performance. I just can remember chasing everything that was green and white. You were just running here, there and everywhere. But Kenny's just sitting back like that, right, go, I'm waiting for you to have another shot. So, but again, as you kind of, you'll know from watching Thistle throughout the years, there's very few times when you go to Celtic Park and come away, is it Wee Geordie's the last player to score there and win, I think, if that record still holds.
Well, at least I was at that game, you know. So I've got those memories.
It's obviously not remembered, but I mean, we put on a fantastic performance, and we then played them, I think it was about 10 days later at Celtic Park on a Sunday, and I think we get beat 4-1 or something like that. But I think the first time that we played there was the cup game, and I think with the energy and the players that we had that were playing against Celtic, and we didn't show them total respect because we wanted to get in their faces. That's just the way we played. But I think at times their quality was second to none. It was off the scale at times, which then showed again when we played them 10 days later because they knew what kind of team we were, resulted in the scoreline.
But at the same time, I mean, you still managed that season, as it turned out, it was going to be your last at Fir Hill, but you know, you still chipped in with 5-6 goals that season. You had, again, a great squad, you know. And throughout all that period, you played with Archie, Scotty Patterson, you know, right through. You and Archie, obviously, both been younger, had come through, you know, as well, you know, although Archie had been at the club longer. But, you know, and you know, when I look back at some of the guys, you know, and again, you had Jerry Britton, you know, sort of there, and that kind of language style that he had as a player.
It was brilliant, but I think that even the like last year as well, when I was assistant manager with Stirling Albion, every time that we would play Clyde, I would see Danny, and there's always that kind of bond with any of the players that you see. I bumped into James McKinstry not that long ago as well, and obviously the bond right away, you're like, oh, how's it going, blah, blah, blah. As I say, Archie probably my lifelong friend probably from being a footballer. You meet that many players, etc., but obviously still really, really friendly with each other since probably the day dot, I think, because Archie played in the left and I played in the left and made a good understanding. And I always remember that, just kind of briefly to give you a wee insight, that we played Kilmarnock at home and I think we beat them 4-1. I think we toasted, scored a hat-trick. And then right midfield, Kilmarnock had Peter Canero playing with him. And I knew Peter because he comes to Clydebank, the same as myself. And obviously he was making a name for himself, rapid, absolutely rapid. And as soon as the kind of the referee flipped the coin, etc., the toss for centre, etc., me and Archie were speaking to each other. And I says to his confirmed, I said, right, Archie, you put him in the jacket. If you don't get him, I will. And lo and behold, the season after it, when I signed for Kilmarnock, that was the first thing Peter Canero says to me. He says, I hated playing against you and Archie. He says, the two of yous would put lumps at me playing against you. Even in the wee cup before, he's like, I'm going to get absolutely toasted here. But again, as I say, it was a good working partnership that me and Archie had in the left-hand side.
How you mentioned about Kilmarnock, actually, we were joking just before you came on. I mean, Chiso, Martin, he played for Killy, the two Airdries, and Morton.
Chose, I mean, well, that's well.
Boys be hell for a Thistle fan.
I know. But and that see the season that obviously we were in the Premier League, and as time was going on nearer towards mm-hmm. the end of the season, we were obviously fighting to stay up, which was the main cause for the team. But obviously the likes of Craigan, Patterson, Archie, Toasty, myself, there was kind of teams knocking on the door as such. And to be fair, I think because the gaffer was leaving, I think that made the decision for players to leave that year easier as such than what it did. Because although Archie and Scotty P went to Dundee United, and Toasty and Craggs went to Motherwell, and I went to Kilmarnock, at that point, I think there was more than two or three clubs wanting all of the players, and I think obviously every player chose their own destination. But again, it was I must say that even in the lead up to the end of the season, speaking from a personal point, at no point was I actually offered a contract to stay at Partick Thistle. So, right. and I say that from the heart. I mean, there was not one contract put on table for me. Yeah. Right, big man, would you like to sign for an extra year, an extra 2 years, or whatever it may be? We'll give you X, Y, and Z. Because mm-hmm. I think a lot of Thistle fans know that all the players were on the same money. We were on the same appearance money, if players probably had an appearance money, and the one bonus was a certain amount, etc. for us. So we didn't have players on, like two players on $3,000, say, and then four players on £500, and then they're playing 10 more games than what these guys are. That's why we were, I think, so much a group together rather than smaller groups. So as I say, there was never a contract there for me to look over. So mm-hmm. again, then when there's two or three clubs that have been Premier League teams consecutively, then I think that's what obviously made the players who left that year obviously take the chance to go to another club.
I'm just wondering if it would have been a different story if John Lambie had been staying on for a couple of years, and you know, the behind the scenes stuff would have been done, all that, you know, would have been organised. It sounds like the club kind of lost their way a wee bit that season.
I think obviously seeing the club, it was probably right for the gaffer. See now, it was probably right for the gaffer to leave, because he had been at Partick Thistle for three periods. Mm-hmm. He was called upon to save the club as such. Obviously, the fans saved the club, which good, the kudos for the fans. And then when the club started to slide, you could see it obviously drifting away, and then the club call on John to come back, and he done that. And then he's waved his magic wand, and the next minute, within 3 years, we're back to being a Premier League club. So what you could probably say is that he's been there, he's done the job asked for, even more so than what he did do. And it probably was the right time for him. Don't get me wrong, I think when he left, he was probably maybe regretting it a wee bit because of the day-to-day lifestyle that the gaffer loved. But I think that probably, as I did say, that probably did split up the squad, because we did have a good, strong squad for the Premier League, albeit it would have been for the bottom half of the league, because of the strength of the other teams that were in the Premier League at that point, where so far, I would probably say, so far more experienced than you look at the Premier League teams now in your positions of 8th, 7th, 6th, etc., and below that as well.
Can you remember in the Premier League players you played against? You know, you mentioned Celtic, you know, and I see Hartson as the lineup, Petrov and players like that, you know, playing against Rangers and Hibs at the time. I think Latipe, and you know, can you remember some of these players and thinking, I'm doing well to compete against these guys? Were you, what was your thoughts on some of them?
Well, the thought process was that we're up against formidable midfield, speaking from a midfield point of view here, but collectively as a team as well, that we need to keep things tight because we're playing against some teams, probably I'd probably say that the top six were of the nature that they were the biggest teams in Scotland at that point, and they were strong and they were throwing a bit of money about, the players that you mentioned. And then obviously from the personal point of view, you want to make your mark, and it didn't matter if I was playing against a player for Dundee or Dundee United or a player from Hearts, Hibs, Celtic or Rangers, I was going to make my mark on them. And I can remember we played Rangers at Fir Hill, and they had a young boy playing right back, Alan Hutton. Now, I can remember it. Seeing a wee skinny 16, 17 year old, and I thought, I'm going to give this guy the fright of his life. And a lot of, as you will know from watching Fir Hill when I played, at Fir Hill, sorry, when I played, that by kicks, free kicks, etc., the ball would come to me and I would flick on because of my aerial presence. So I think Alan Hutton was substituted at half time, and then it wasn't until he actually went to Tottenham Hotspur for the measly sum of £10 million, I may add, that Alex McLeish had a bit in the paper saying, battered by big mad mental Martin Hardie to the tune of £10 million. And I thought, well, I must have been remembered for something, you know what I mean?
Did they not give you a cut then, no?
No. But again, as I say, that the players we played against and the teams we played, Hearts were really strong, Hibs were really strong with that bit of flair. And I think you'll probably remember yourselves that we played Hearts at Tynecastle. And they had obviously Presley, Craig Gordon, De Vries up front, the midfielder Stamp. He was from
Middlesbrough,
I think it was. I'm trying to think it, but they were a huge team, like physically strong, physically in stature, a typical Craig Levein team, as you would say. And I can remember I don't know if it was nothing each or one each or whatever at Tynecastle when the balls came in, and I've had a header. It's by Craig Gordon. It gets headed off the line. Craig Gordon picks it up. He throws it to Alan Mabry. He's charging up the line, 92nd minute or something it is. He cuts inside, goes to play a pass, a diagonal, I think, to De Vries. It hits one of our defenders, comes back to him, and he unleashes this 40-yard strike, and it ends up in the top bin, and you're just going, what chance have you got when there's stuff like that happening? Do you know what I mean? But again, it was great for that, for the squad that John Lambie had built, especially the players who were in the second division and remained all the way through to eventually get to the end of the season and remain and keep the club up in the Premier League.
But I mean, yeah, after ourselves and Kelly, you Deirdre, you'd had a really successful time at St Johnstone, Scottish Cup semi-finals, and almost a goal in every four games, I think you were kind of averaging roughly there. Then Dunfermline, so I want to finish off. You know where this is going, Martin, don't you? You know what season I'm going to talk about.
What season is that you're going to say?
Season 12-13 at Lorton. I'll be quite honest with you, I thought, having watched you, Kelly Airdrie, St Johnstone, Dunfermline, and seen your games, I thought since you left Thistle, your season at Morton was probably the best I'd seen you play since you'd left Thistle, because I don't know, it was like every time you played us, you ran the game.
I think I was 36 at that point, and when I, just to kind of go back maybe one or two years, so when I left St Johnstone, obviously I had this knee injury that a lot of people thought that's Martin Hardie done because of the way I played the game, etc. But it actually, because I had a break of roughly 14 months because I had two operations in my knee, I kind of, the body recovered slightly, and then I went to Dunfermline, went up to the Premier League. That year when I played midfield, it probably, I was starting to kind of wilt with the legs a wee bit, and then Jim McIntyre eventually put me as a second striker as such. Not directly up front, but I would always kind of come short rather than, a striker who would run into the channel. So the next season again, when I went to Morton, I thought, well, this is the position that I'm going to end up finishing my career as, because obviously, as you know, I had a goal to game ratio of roughly 1-3, 1-4.
Yeah.
And then Alan Moore decided, no, he says, listen, big man, I think you'd be suited to playing holding midfield. And holding midfield, it wasn't a holding midfield for me role.
No.
Because I think I actually scored 10 goals that year.
That's but right.
The wee tight pitch suited me. I had Michael Tidzer and Freddie Bakaru in front of me. And I would just, I think it was probably my age and a bit of, I need to kind of show that I can play this position as well, because I knew myself I did have technical ability, because at times for Thistle and St Johnson more, I would end up becoming like a winger out wide and try to beat defenders and put crosses in the box, as well as obviously an aerial threat and tackling and everything that went with the game. But when I played that role, it really suited me in terms of the age I was, the players mm-hmm. that I had in front of me, the players I had behind me, who would trust me to say, because obviously I was very vocal when I played and such. So if the defenders gave it to the fullback, I was always screaming, why are you giving them it? Give it to me, because I want to dictate the play here. So it was a role that I slid into, but I fitted into it really well. Obviously that season, I had an Indian summer, I think is what it's called. I really did enjoy it that year. Obviously, we're here to talk about Partick Thistle, and it was a great season for probably both teams to be going head to head, and it was the young v old, and it was when Jackie left, and obviously for me, pleasing to see Archie getting the job, and he obviously took it on again, and it was to and fro, and kind of the older guys like myself and Mark McLaughlin and Peter McDonald, we're sitting back and we're just like, thank God that game's done, man. That was tough. Do you know what I mean? And the younger team, they're all full of energy and blah blah blah. So it was a fantastic season, and I always usually send Archie a wee text just to say, you're lucky that fog came in that night at Cowden Beef.
Cowden Beef, I know. You're probably right about that. But also that season, playing in front of big crowds, because the crowds were coming back for both clubs.
They were. I mean, when you look at the final game as such, which eventually put us to bed, Thistle had the main... Morton had the main stand at Fir Hill full.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Jackie was full, and then behind the goal was full. So that, therefore, suggests that for a team, this is what I believe, that as much as it may out some fans, are you better off watching your team in the Premier League scraping for points, no losing as much, or would fans rather see their team winning a championship and kind of yo-yoing, do you know what I mean? Because the crowds are always up higher in the championship, which therefore generates more money. But when you go and win the league, you're going up to the Premier League. I personally think that if you're a fan of a Premier League club, i.e. like St Johnson, when we won the league, they've not come out of the Premier League since. Yeah. But they're great, do you know what I mean? So there's a balance there, do you know what I mean? But, I mean, I think it was over 10,000, I think, was it not?
Yeah, definitely. That night, it was absolutely jumping. It was great right. atmosphere, it was brilliant.
Yeah. And even the games before that, the Boxing Day game, where Morton actually won it at Fir Hill. It was a fantastic crowd. Obviously, at that time, the crowds are up as well. It was a fantastic game, and the two games down at Capel were great games as well. So it was a fantastic season for both clubs, and then obviously, eventually, Thistle pulled through at the end, which, on a personal note, I was delighted for Thistle and Archie. As a personal friend, that they got up into the Premier League, and then after that, I would always, if there was, because the games had, they were either Friday night or there was midweek games, etc. I would always be up watching Thistle when Archie was the manager.
And if you do you still enjoy a wee trip to Blackpool? now and again.
I've never been to Blackpool since.
Are you bad?
No. I never actually really enjoyed going to Blackpool, believe it or not, but obviously that's the burning question. What happened in Blackpool? And we obviously went down there. We landed. I will tell you a couple of stories, because when I speak to people out with football that are North Thistle fans, and who did you play for? And I'll say, oh, I played for Partick Thistle. Oh, did you throw Lambie in the water or not? But that was obviously the generation before us. But we're staying in the hotel, and the year before we stayed in this hotel, it was like Fawlty Towers. It was embarrassing, to be fair. But that was, we just got on it, you know what I mean? And we stayed right in the beachfront, and we were doing a double session. So we're training in the morning, walked across the road onto the beach. The tide is out as far as can be, and there's like, I don't know, probably about a mile of sand from pier to pier before you can see the water. And we goes out in the morning, and the next minute, Lambie, and we're going, I don't see the bag of balls here, by the way, lads. No, there's a few. I've caught on to Lambie. He just turns to Danny, and he went, right, Danny, 20 minutes, you have got up to that pier, and then up to that pier, and back. Can't believe it. So we've done the run, and we're away up. So we'd maybe done like a 5K or something like that on the beach, but we had acres. You could have played about three pitches of 11-a-side games on this beach at the point, because the time was out that much. So then in the afternoon, we comes out to train. We'll get the cones, we'll get the balls. Yes, brilliant, what a game. And the tide's in. There must have been about 8 metres from the seawall to the sea. And the gaffer's got us playing 5-a-side on the beach. And when the tide's out, as you would probably know, that the sand was perfect, but the sand was bobbly, and people are falling over the ball, and ankles nearly getting broken and stuff like that. And you're just thinking, oh, that's just bonkers. But obviously, as the gaffer, as you don't know, he used to take his pigeons down to Blackpool and stuff like that. And to be fair to him, he would allow us to relax at night and have a few beers, but there was always a curfew, obviously. So we'd be in the hotel for probably before midnight. But a wee funny story that the gaffer took, we'd heard that the gaffer was signing a player for a club in Belgium. So we were quite perplexed about, I wonder who this player is. So he was coming to Blackpool. And so when we gets to Blackpool, it was the gaffer's pal. We were going, is that the gaffer's pal? There's no player coming. So obviously he must have been friends through the Do convention or whatever. So him and the gaffer are sharing the room. So we've been allowed to go out and relax. We've had a couple of beers, etc. Obviously, we've come back in, and the usual suspects, right? I don't need to mention them, but I will. No. Jerry Britton, Archie Toasty, myself, Kevin Budd, Trigger, Scotty P. Up to no good. So the gaffer of this room, where when you put the key in, the door opened back towards you, rather than obviously opening the door to get into the room. So the gaffer had been on the whiskey with his pal, and Big Jerry, myself, they were in the hallway was like a chest of drawers or whatever, right? So we've all shifted this chest of drawers, kind of, it was about 6 foot, right? We've slid it up towards the door, and one of the players has got shaving foam. So he goes into the room, and the gaffer's lying sleeping, and he's put shaving foam in both his hands, and then he's squirted it in his mouth, right? So the gaffer's woke up, and he's coughing and spluttering, and then obviously he doesn't realise that he's got shaving foam on his hands. So the first thing you naturally do is you go to wipe your hands. But what we've done is we've put the wardrobe in front of the gaffer's door, because it was like a, he had like kind of communal toilet across his door, so he couldn't get out the room. And he's shouting from his room, "I'm effing telling you, you're off, find a week's wages. I'm going to tell you, Britton, Hardy, Archibald, Parson, Burns, Budanikis, Trigger, week's wages, I know it's all you." You know, he's sitting outside the room. I ain't bother, Gaffer, because obviously we had that, we had a top deal on us, but the next day he comes up and he pulls us and he's like, "I'm warning you, don't ever do that to me again, but I like your camaraderie." So as far as the rest of them or are concerned, he's fined a week's wages, and we're like, right, no bother. So we obviously had to tell the group of players that we were fined a week's wages, so obviously there was no more carry on.
It's absolutely brilliant.
That's brilliant.
Just, like, Donald, you had a team that Martin had picked.
Oh, yes, this was the player from different nations that you played with.
Yeah. I think.
And you picked Archie as the Scottish one.
Yep.
I just thought that was quite interesting that you'd picked Archie, but obviously you kind of said throughout while we've been talking to you, the relationship you'd had with Archie. But you put Kevin Budnakis down as Polish.
I had to throw that name in as Polish. I know he's not Polish. No. But Budnakis, obviously the Polish surname, if you're not on the Bobby Ball, as you would say, being a Thistle fan, then you'll say, "Oh God, he must have actually been Polish." But it was only goalkeeper, and I couldn't have put Kevin Klein in, or Calvin Klein, whatever his name is.
Well, I think an absolutely fantastic hour, Martin, that we've had with you. It has been an absolute blast to have you back on, and you know, to have you on and see you looking so well and hear the stories. So thank you so much for coming on with us this morning. And I know the golf course is probably be waiting on you at some point this weekend. So
I actually played yesterday, Raymond. Had a wee hit at Mar Hall just over at Erskine.
Not just Mar Hall then, Martin. Aye.
Mar Hall, yeah. Like it. 12 over par, so I need to improve.
I believe you've got the time now as well. A wee bit of time now that everything's starting to kind of get back to a little bit more normality. I'm expecting to hear when I speak to you next time the handicap being done. I'm expecting the speech to be going back and forward.
Hopefully, and as I say, we're in this period here where health, family, and staying safe is the most important thing. And
yeah.
I think there's a lot of rush to get football back on. We all love it. We want it to return, but first and foremost, we need to be safe in terms of getting everything instead of getting it pushed through. But obviously, whatever league Partick Thistle may be in, hopefully they can get back up and start challenging, hopefully for the championship. If not, then we just go and win League One. We blow the teams out the water. We get back up and hopefully do what our team done in the second division, the first division, and then hopefully they can, under Ian McCall, succeed in that and try and get back up to the Premier League.
Well said, thanks very much. Brilliant.
Thanks, lads.
On behalf of Donners, Mr. Jags 365, Alan Fraser, number 7, and our very special guest, Martin Hardie, a big thank you for joining us again this week. We'll be back again next weekend with another special guest, of which we'll probably get Donners to make up another little preview again for you all to see. But in the meantime, as Matt says, stay here, stay safe, stay here.
It's going so well, Raymond.
Well done, Raymond.
Cheers, guys. Thanks.
Cheers. Brilliant. Yes.
Martin Hardie. Martin Hardie. Ooh, Martin Hardie.